should threaten to undo us. We will not fear, for God has willed His truth to triumph through us. The Prince of Darkness grim, we tremble not for Him. His rage we can endure, for lo, His doom is sure. One little word shall fail Him. That word above all earthly powers, no thanks to them abideth. The Spirit and the gifts are ours, through Him who with us sided. Let goods and kindred go, this mortal life also, the body they may kill. God's truth abideth still. His kingdom forever.
This is my Father's world. This is my Father's world. I rest me in the thought of rocks and trees, of skies and seas. His hand the wonders wrought. This is my Father's world. The birds their carols raise, the morning light, the lily white, declare their Maker's praise. This is my Father's world. He shines in all that's fair. Speaks to me everywhere. This is my Father's world. Oh, let me ne'er forget that though the wrong seems oft so strong, God is the ruler yet. This is my Father's world. The battle
Lord be with you. Good morning and a warm welcome to all. A special welcome to our guests and visitors here today. Good to have you a part of Emmanuel and our worshiping community, both here and online. My name is Glenn Schlecht, senior pastor here at Emmanuel. And this morning we are continuing on, getting close to the end of our summer series, Living in Tension, as we've been working our way through 1 and 2 Kings, or 1, 2 Samuel, 1 Kings, and looking at the tension that seems to have always been a part of our world. We looked at it with the prophet Samuel, with King Saul, King David, and now as we continue here today with King Solomon. So many things that we can relate to. And this morning we are asking the question, what is happiness? And a question I want to kind of set in your mind, we'll begin the sermon with it, is what's your goal in life? Start thinking about that as we think about why we're here, who we are, and what happiness is, exploring that through the eyes of King Solomon. So with that, let's begin with a word of prayer. Would you join me? Father in heaven, as we gather here this morning, we come with grateful hearts, grateful that we can come again into your presence at your invitation. You know the many needs that we brought into this time of worship, people, circumstances, life itself, that at times weigh pretty heavy on our hearts and minds. And I pray that this time in your presence, that you will do what you do best, that you would bring to the table what you know we need. And so we trust you, we love you, and we have come again to worship you. So we place ourselves and our time together now into your loving hands, asking all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. And I invite all who are able to please stand as we begin with the invocation and our opening hymn. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. From Psalm 34, the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are attentive to their cry. The righteous cry out, and the Lord hears them. He delivers them from all their troubles. The righteous person may have many troubles, but the Lord delivers him from them all. Evil will slay the wicked. The foes of the righteous will be condemned. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father, first in the quiet of our hearts, and then together in the spoken confession. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of the Word, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray together. O God, the source of all that is just and good, nourish in us every virtue and bring to completion every good intent, that we may grow in grace and bring forth the fruit of good works. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated as we hear from God in his Word.
The Old Testament reading this morning is from select verses from 1 Kings. When the Queen of Sheba heard about the fame of Solomon and his relationship to the Lord, she came to test Solomon with hard questions. Arriving at Jerusalem with a very great caravan, with camels carrying spices, large quantities of gold and precious stones, she came to Solomon and talked with him about all that she had on her mind. Solomon answered all her questions. Nothing was too hard for the king to explain to her. When the Queen of Sheba saw all the wisdom of Solomon and the palace he had built, the food on his table, the seating of his officials, the attending servants in their robes, his cupbearers and the burnt offerings he made at the temple of the Lord, she was overwhelmed. She said to the king, "The report I heard in my own country about your achievements and your wisdom is true, but I did not believe these things until I came and saw with my own eyes. Indeed, not even half was told to me. In wisdom and wealth, you have far exceeded the report I heard. How happy your people must be! How happy our officials! your officials who continually stand before you and hear your wisdom. Praise be to the Lord your God, who has delighted in you and placed you on the throne of Israel. Because of the Lord's eternal love for Israel, he has made you king to maintain justice and righteousness. And she gave the king 120 talents of gold, large quantities of spices and precious stones. Never again were so many spices brought in as those the queen of Sheba gave to King Solomon. King Solomon was greater in riches and wisdom than all the other kings of the earth. The whole world sought audience with Solomon to hear the wisdom God had put in his heart. Year after year, everyone who came brought a gift: articles of silver and gold, robes, weapons and spices, and horses and mules. King Solomon, however, loved many foreign women besides Pharaoh's daughter. So Solomon did evil in the eyes of the Lord. He did not follow the Lord completely as David his father had done. The Lord became angry with Solomon because his heart had turned away from the Lord, the God of Israel, who had appeared to him twice. Although he had forbidden Solomon to follow other gods, Solomon did not keep the Lord's command. As for the other events of Solomon's reign, all he did and the wisdom he displayed, are they not written in the book of the Annals of Solomon? Solomon reigned in Jerusalem over all Israel 40 years. Then he rested with his ancestors and was buried in the city of David, his father. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle reading this morning is from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, chapter 12. Therefore, in order to keep me from becoming conceited, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan, to torment me. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me, but he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness." Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. This is the word of the Lord. Please stand for the reading of the gospel. Our gospel reading this morning is from the book of John, chapter 6. Jesus answered, "The work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent." So they asked him, "What sign then will you give that we may see it and believe you? What will you do? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, 'He gave them bread from heaven to eat.'" Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is the bread that comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." "Sir," they said, "always give us this bread." Then Jesus declared, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." This is the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated.
And if I could have the children come on forward for this morning's children's message, and any parents or adults that want to join, you're welcome to come as well.
All right. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay, what are some things that make you happy? What are some things that make you happy? Your family, Your toys? Your school? Maybe? Okay, this is a tough crowd this morning, so we'll just get to it. Bubbles make me happy. So, I think bubbles are so cool and so fun, but the problem is, eventually they pop. You can keep blowing bubbles, and this is like the biggest thing in bubbles, we could be here all day, but eventually they will all pop and go away. And that's the thing that happens with our feelings. Sometimes we feel happy, sometimes we feel sad, sometimes we feel mad, but they change all the time. Our feelings always change. They come and they go and they never stay the exact same. But we know that all these feelings that we have, God cares about each of our feelings, and He especially cares about when we're happy. He loves seeing us happy, and He gives us so many things in our lives to make us happy. You guys just couldn't think of any of this. But I know there are so many things that make you happy. And we're reminded that those are gifts from God and that He cares about us so much that He gives us those things and He reminds us of His love. So all those things that make us happy ultimately remind us that God loves us so much and cares for us that He continues to give us these good things. And so I want you to be thankful for all those things, knowing that they are gifts from God. And I'm going to give you some bubbles that you can take home, or you can also blow them during church. I don't really care. But have someone in your family help you open them because they're kind of hard. But let's pray first, and then you can grab some bubbles. Repeat after me. Dear God, thank you so much for giving us all the things that make us happy. Help us remember they're gifts from you. Amen. All right, come grab some bubbles.
Thanks, Miss Martha. So, to get us engaged in what we're going to be thinking about today right off the bat, as I mentioned in the welcome, I want to start today with a question. What is your goal in life? Now, I'm not talking day-to-day kind of stuff, that I want to lose weight, want to eat right, want to read the Bible every day. Take it up to a much higher level. What is more of an overarching goal for you? One, maybe two, but these higher level goals as far as what you want to do, what you want to be, where you want to go, as far as a goal in life. So take a moment to think about that if you're comfortable and would like to talk with each other about this, to kind of bounce some things around, feel free to do that. What is your goal in life? Take a moment. All right, I'm not going to take responses because I'm guessing it may be a bit all over the board, but I would love to hear from you in terms of what some of your goals in life are. Feel free to message me, send me a text, send me an email, and I'd be curious to hear a little bit. But where I want to go with this is with a much more specific question. Should happiness be our ultimate goal in life? Now, think the Declaration of Independence. Life, liberty, and what? The pursuit of happiness. It's what America's all about, right? It is among those inalienable rights that have been endowed to all human beings from our Creator. Those are the very words embedded in our founding documents. It is the American way, isn't it? From what I've been hearing and seeing and sensing, and this, not just recent, but for a number of years, what I'm getting from our culture, what I'm hearing and seeing in social media, and from a wide variety of other, granted non-scientific, but observations that I've been making, I would have to say that happiness is among the top goals for us in America. That people just want to be happy. My question for us today is, does happiness belong at that level? Should happiness be our goal? So let's go to Solomon. We heard about Solomon again today. And would you say that he was happy over all that he had, that he should be happy? Okay, quick review to bring us all up to speed. Let's go back to much earlier in 1 Kings, back to chapter 4. This is a part of what God laid out and how God blessed Solomon, some of what he gave to him. And we didn't hear this in previous weeks, but this is kind of this expanded explanation of what God, from his very hand, endowed Solomon with. So listen to this. It's a little bit lengthy, these five kind of long verses, but it gives us a sense of Solomon, who he was, where he was at. Listen. God gave Solomon wisdom and very great insight and a breadth of understanding as measureless as the sand on the seashore. Solomon's wisdom was greater than the wisdom of all the people of the East and greater than all the wisdom of Egypt. He was wiser than anyone else, including, and then he goes on to name four different guys, and hats off to them for getting a shout out for being the wisest people in the world. But then he goes on, and his fame spread to all the surrounding nations. He spoke 3,000 proverbs, and his songs numbered 1,005. He spoke about plant life, from the cedar of Lebanon to the hyssop that grows out of walls. He also spoke about animals and birds, reptiles and fish. From all the nations, people came to listen to Solomon's wisdom, sent by all the kings of the world who had heard of his wisdom. And specifically in today's reading, who came? The Queen of Sheba came to test him and to check out all that she had heard. And we're told that she brought some tough questions for him, and Solomon answered them all. Solomon was, in my, to use a phrase from my growing up, he was essentially a walking encyclopedia. In today's language, he's a living, breathing Google, or Google search engine, that there was nothing that he didn't know. He could answer every question. And that wasn't all. There was even more. We'll go back one more chapter to 1 Kings chapter 3, just again to get the lay of the land as far as who Solomon was. So God told Solomon, in addition to a wise and discerning heart, I will give you what you have not asked for, both wealth and honor, so that in your lifetime you will have no equal among kings. And so we've heard. Solomon had it all. Wealth, fame, honor, and everything, it seemed, that was the desire of his heart. He was literally, of all the people of the world, He was the man standing at the top of it all. He was, like his father David, what we would consider a Renaissance man. A man who knew it all, could do it all, had it all. Did these things make Solomon happy? It didn't seem like it. We heard that Solomon, again, is a part of today's reading. Solomon had literally hundreds of wives and even more hundreds of mistresses, none of which pleased God. In fact, it angered him. He had told him otherwise. This was not right. And he had warned him, in part, what was going to happen, that all these wives, all these mistresses were going to turn his heart away from God. And wouldn't you know, that's exactly what happened. And not just in a, oh, oops, kind of way, but it was awful, detestable, even abominable, as his heart was turned toward all sorts of idols, all sorts of false gods, and not just acknowledging them or letting them exist in his kingdom, but actually accepting them, embracing them, encouraging them. And we're talking some of the sex cults that were very much a part of Old Testament history. We're talking about child sacrifices that also were a part of some of these false gods. It was detestable and absolutely abominable what Solomon was doing. Also, there are many who believe that Solomon wrote the Old Testament book of Ecclesiastes. And to read through that book of Ecclesiastes, you'll find many, many good and helpful things as God inspired him to write that. But in reading that, there's also this sense that the writer of Ecclesiastes battled depression, suffered depression, or at the very least, a very pessimistic outlook on life. And yet, we hear this about Solomon, but how many of us wouldn't want to give Solomon's lifestyle just a little try? Maybe just a week or a month, a couple of days, and, you know, I think we could withstand some of those temptations of power and fame, right? I love country music, and there is a kind of a goofy country song. It goes like this. I'm just going to share a couple of lines here. I'm not going to say the title because it's right in it. It'll give it away. But listen, that, I believe, describes kind of a lay of the land, including us at times. It goes, I know everybody, I'm not going to sing it, don't worry, I'm just going to say the lines. I know everybody says money can't buy happiness, but it could buy me a boat, it could buy me a truck to pull it, man, go ahead and join me, it could buy me a Yeti 110 iced down with some silver bullets. Yeah, and I know what they say, money can't buy everything. Maybe so, but it can buy me a boat. That would be the life, wouldn't it? Eat, drink, and be merry. Have your boat, have your truck, and that's happiness. Or is it? What should be our pursuit in life? What should be our goal in life? What is true happiness? What does that pursuit of happiness look like? How do we go about that? And they're all somewhat different questions, but very much parallel, very much the same, in the same vein. And I'm not going to have you think about this, talk about this. I just want to hear, what is your gut reaction to that? What should be our pursuit or goal in life? What is true happiness? What does that pursuit of happiness look like? What are you thinking? David? Okay, to live in peace, serenity, and in His grace the rest of my days. All right? Other things. Different. Parallel. Similar to that. Go, Greg. Okay, to try to discern God's will for your life. And then, I would add, with the Spirit's help, try to do it. Try to live out that will that God has for us. Okay? What else? Other takes. Shanna? Okay, good. So keeping your eyes on Jesus, trying to do what He would have you do by way of example, by way of life, by way of aligning my life, our lives with His. Good. Good. Any other variances? Pat? Okay. Try your hardest to follow the two great commandments, which are love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Okay? Excellent. Thank you for that, John. A distinction between happiness and joy. And there is a difference for us as followers of Jesus between happiness and joy. John said, you know, we don't sing happiness to the world, the Lord has come at Christmas. We sing joy to the world, the Lord has come. And there is a difference between the two. Very good. But Joe, one more.
I think it's a condition of the heart. It's not what we do. I mean, I hear all the striving stuff. I think our goal is to have a heart of Him. You look at David, his father, and you look at this pastor this morning. Solomon had all this stuff, but he had a heart for it. All these things would make him happy, but his heart turned away from the Lord. And you go back to the stories you shared with us before. David, in his darkest moment with Bathsheba, was pierced with
nice. Well put. So it's what Joe was saying is it's a condition of the heart. And where's our heart at? Well, we heard from Solomon. His heart was turned away from God. You go back to King David, his darkest moment of with Bathsheba. And that prayer coming out of that was in Psalm 51, create in me a pure heart, O God. And renew that steadfast spirit. And so the condition of our heart, where is our heart at? And over again throughout the scriptures, God says, I don't want your sacrifices. Bottom line, I mean, I've set those up to do for a specific purpose, but when all is said and done, I care less about your sacrifices. I want your heart. That's what he wants. Well put. All of these, the different nuances that this is all about. You look at our reading, you get the sense from 1 Kings 10 and 11. You get it also in reading Ecclesiastes that a life that is not centered on God is purposeless and meaningless. We can have all the stuff. Riches, fame, honor, even wisdom and knowledge and discernment. But if our sights are not centered on Jesus, we're never going to be satisfied. And we're certainly never going to be happy. Let's go to a different time period. St. Paul, first century. In our second reading for today from 2 Corinthians, we've got Solomon on this end of the spectrum who has it all, and then we swing down with St. Paul in today's reading, and he is referring to this thorn in the flesh, some malady, some ailment, something, we're not sure exactly what it was, but it was making life really hard for St. Paul. Made it tough. In fact, we're told he pleaded 3 times for the Lord to take it away, and God chose not to. And so he lived in many ways in relative poverty, in prison, so often dealing with this particular thorn in the flesh. And regardless of how hard life may be, how many stresses or challenges we may face, how weak we may feel, how much stuff we have or don't have, the Lord came to Paul and comes to us, told us, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness. No matter where it is that we find ourselves on this spectrum, on the Solomon end, on the St. Paul end, the Lord directs us over and over again back to himself to trust him with whatever may be going on in life, with whatever it is that we may be going through. He promises us that his grace is sufficient. It's enough. That's what we need. Do you believe that? Do you believe God's grace is sufficient? I'm going to give you a moment to think on this one. And again, if comfortable, talk about it. I'd like to hear from you out of this one. Do you believe God's grace is sufficient for you? Why or why not? Take a moment, please. So what do you think? Is God's grace enough? Why or why not? Elaine? Because he said so. That's a big one, isn't it? He laid it out there. We believe God. We believe what He's given us in His Word is true. That God is who He said He is. If He said it, it's true. Can we go beyond that? Maybe not, but in some practical terms, let's. Art? Sorry, say it one more time. Okay, again, more scripture, back to His Word, His promise. I am with you always to the very end of the age. I will always be there. Good. Bill? Perfect. That grace is shown to us through Jesus. Jesus is grace personified. Undeserved love. Unmerited gifts. And it's demonstrated for us in His ultimate, not only life, but His suffering, His death, that sacrifice on the cross, as payment, perfect payment for all sin, and His victorious resurrection from the dead. Grace seen in Jesus. Other thoughts with this? Gene? Yeah, if you don't feel His grace is sufficient, what are you doing here? Why worship? So, yeah, I'm kind of assuming all y'all are there, that you do believe His grace is sufficient. But it doesn't mean that we can't struggle with it at times and wonder. I mean, that's the brokenness. That can be the difficulty in life, that we get pressed on it to say, God, are you here? Where are you? But for us to know, we come week in, week out. We come to His Word each day. We pray each day. Because we believe it. We know it. Good. Thanks for that. Joe?
My brother asked me a question. To your question, which I thought was good. How could it not be? We live in this crazy world and we ask those questions, right? So what would it look like? What more can we possibly ask for? The creator of the world would become one of us and die for us. If you come up with a better solution, I mean, I'd be really curious to what it could be.
Yeah. Yeah, how could it not be? What better solution could we come up with? There isn't one. His grace, again, through Jesus, life, death, resurrection. Unconditional love, all personified. Arlen? Okay, grace is sufficient that it gives us eternal life. Which is where we're headed. An ultimate goal, an ultimate end for us as Christians to look forward to the new creation, to life renewed once again. God's grace is sufficient. That grace brings to us contentment in life. It's part of what Solomon struggled with, wasn't it? I would guess. Something I would believe many of us struggle with at times. Contentment. But for us to know with that grace is sufficient, to know that we truly do have everything that we need in Christ. He brings freedom. Freedom that comes to us by way of forgiveness for our sin. Forgiveness that allows us to walk through this life not feeling guilty at every turn or guilty over every decision or everything that is going on. We don't have to be guilty. We don't have to feel guilty. We don't have to carry that guilt with us because His grace is sufficient. That we know that life is more than following rules, but it's being able to live with joy. To know that we live with the purpose that He has given to us. To live life abundantly, with joy, with purpose, and by His grace. And He brings us hope. Knowing that no matter what happens in this world, regardless of COVID or masks or vaccines or shutdowns, regardless of wars and chaos and uncertainties and fears, we have hope because of Jesus. Through His death, through His resurrection, as you mentioned, Arlen, that hope is what is ours. Jesus provides it in all times. We can know that we're His. His grace, His love, His presence, it's enough. The what now for today? If you want to grab your Bring It Home insert, it's also up there on the screen. Take time this week to think about what you've been pursuing in life. What are your goals, as we've been talking about today? As you do, let Jesus shape or reshape some of your thinking, pursuing and living with the gift of His grace and the hope He brings to the table. In Jesus, with Jesus, and for Jesus. Amen. And that peace of God, a peace that at times goes beyond our understanding, let it guard our hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus, today and always. Amen. Stand, and we join in making confession of our faith, a faith that is grounded in grace, as we speak the words this morning of the Apostles' Creed, these truths drawn from the very truth of God's own Word, of the mystery and wonder of this triune God whom we serve and who is here in our midst. God's people have been professing this for hundreds and hundreds of years. And again this morning, we have the privilege of joining our voices with those who have gone before us and with those who stand here and around the world on this faith in our God. Please join me. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated, and our time of offering that we pause each worship service is again very much a part of who we are, created in the image of God, as people who have been created to give. The Lord has poured by his grace so much into our lives and into our world that this is that opportunity each week to just briefly pause and remember that we're not the owners, that we've been entrusted with so much. And out of gratitude, out of our thanks to God, we give what we do, a tenth or so of our finances. We give of our time and of who we are, not because we have to, not out of obligation, but out of our Lord's love for us and ours for him. So, join me as we once again today reiterate some of these beautiful promises from God's own word with regard to this gift and this grace of giving. Friends of Christ, we know that all we have, all we are, and all we do is a gift from God. God does not need our gifts, but he knows that life is better when we share generously from all that we have of our time, talents, and treasures. As we give our offerings, a tenth or so, we're giving thanks to God the Father for his abundant gifts to us. Heavenly Father, give us your grace to share generously, and in doing so, be refreshed in you. Amen. In our prayers today, we remember the following. Prayers for a neighbor of Becky and Sean York, who earlier this week was dealing with blood clots in her lungs. From Linda Boudin, prayers for Gary, Tricia, and their daughter, who have been through a lot with various surgeries and some very serious medical issues. For Dan Harple, who discovered that his most recent shoulder surgery has failed. Prayers for peace for him and for wisdom and direction for the doctors who are trying to help him. For Shirley Gonzalez, who is continuing to struggle with health and medical-related issues. Doctors, again, here not being able to figure everything out. So prayers for healing, for patience, and for wisdom for the doctors. We also want to pray for our ministry together. A quick update that we will pray about. Our call or search team for a director of youth and young adult ministries had 3 interviews on Tuesday. Went very well. We've got one young man who stood out that we are going to continue conversation with. Marcus Howard and his fiancée, Ileana, are going to be here September 18th to the 20th. They'll be coming out for a visit to meet with us and have some continued conversation and see if this is where God is leading us and them. And then, of course, we continue to pray for all of the happenings in our country and around the world, including ongoing concerns and issues surrounding COVID, natural disasters, hurricanes, tropical storms that are brewing, and Afghanistan, Haiti, and the fires in our region. So let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. God of all mercy, God of all grace, we lay before you the needs of our heart. There are many. We've expressed a few, but we've carried into this time of worship so many more. People that are on our hearts and minds, circumstances, situations that trouble us, that maybe scare us, that concern us. We also bring to you the joys of our heart, grateful of knowing that you're here. Your love is real. We see it, we experience it, we believe it. And so, Lord, as our Father, as our Creator, as our Savior and Redeemer, we commend these matters, big and small, to your loving care, praying for your grace to abound and for your will to be done. Lord, in your mercy, for our ministries here at Emmanuel, we give you thanks for the opportunities we have to serve you in so many ways. And we pray today for Marcus and Eliana as we continue conversation in a search for a new director of youth and young adult ministries. Lord, guide us, direct us. That has been our prayer all along. And if Marcus is the man you have in mind, make it clear for us. We continue to look to you and seek you out in the weeks to come. And Lord, as we make final preparations for all sorts of fall activities, getting ready to start up once again, we pray that you would help us to keep Jesus front and center. That his grace be that foundation on which we stand and teach and share and do all that we do. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for our country and for our world. Lord, there's so much that is going on that at times we have to scratch our heads. We're not even sure what to pray for anymore. But Lord, you know the needs. With natural disasters, with man-made disasters, all the evil that we see poking its head up in so many places. Lord, help us to understand and remember that our purpose is centered in you and in your grace, to know that your grace is indeed sufficient. And I pray that all that we are and do as your body around this world would exemplify your grace, would show it and share it in love, in perseverance, in the actions that we show. Lord, we pray for those who are hurting, who've been impacted in any number of ways from any of the things going on, be it loss of life, loss of material, house, home, and other things. We commend these to your care, praying for your guidance, your help, your healing. Lord, in your mercy, for President Biden and other world leaders, for all those elected and appointed through every level of our government, we commend them to your care and pray that you would grant to them wisdom to act not on their own or out of self-centered agendas or misdirected ideas, but that they would govern on the basis and foundation of your truth, of your word, of your grace. You know what's best, Lord, and help us and help our leaders to trust you in that. We also commend to you all those who are on our front lines. We pray for healthcare professionals, for law enforcement, first responders, firefighters, and all those who serve in our military. Lord, protect them in these very dangerous times. Times of uncertainty, times of unknown. But we thank you for those who are willing to put themselves in harm's way, even to put their lives on the line, for our health, our safety, our well-being, and for the freedoms we enjoy. Watch over them, Lord. And we pray that you would mitigate the loss of life in some of these matters that are going on around our world right now. Lord, in your mercy, into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who has also taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And so we come to the table. We come to receive again his grace, his love, at our Lord's own invitation to us. He knows us, and he knows what we need. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also after supper, he took the cup. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant that is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." If there are any of you here today wondering whether or not you should come and receive the Lord's Supper, would you ask yourself these four questions? First, do you know Jesus? Do you trust in him, believe in him as your Lord and Savior? Second, do you acknowledge the sin and brokenness in your own heart and in your own life, and desire the forgiveness and the healing that the Lord offers here? Third, do you believe our Lord's words, profound, mysterious words that go beyond our ability to understand it completely? But do you believe it to be true? That what we receive today goes far beyond just bread and wine and is also the very body and blood of Jesus? And finally, fourth, would be your intention with the Holy Spirit to work in your heart and in your life, that you would look for those opportunities to express that beautiful truth that his grace is sufficient. If you answered yes to these questions, this gift is for you. We have two serving stations on either end of the communion rail. Children and young people not yet instructed in the Lord's Supper, you're invited to come for a blessing. Or if they're adults who would prefer simply to receive a blessing today, please come with your hands folded to indicate that. Otherwise, have your hands open for the bread. My friends, the peace of the Lord be with you always. able to please stand. Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you steadfast in true faith, now and for life everlasting. Amen. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us with the healing power of this gift of life. You filled us with joy through your love and grace. We've tasted of your goodness and of your glory. Now strengthen us by the grace and forgiveness we've received in this sacrament, that we may live holy and godly lives as witnesses in this world. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. Seated for just a moment longer. Thank you once again for joining together here in person and online for our time of worship. And I pray as we think about our goals in life, we think about what true happiness is and where that is found, that you've got some things to think about, that we all do as we step into the week ahead. But we have an announcement, a couple things, a reminder of the Nappy Project, the opportunity to donate diapers for people in our community. That'll be out there for the next couple of weeks. Next Sunday will be our last outdoor service. Does not impact all of you who normally attend 8 o'clock, but in 2 weeks, our schedule will change back to our regular schedule with 8 o'clock and 10:30 worship here with our 9:30 education hour, September 12th. Don't forget, that is our ministry fair. Children, youth ministries, or classes, those will begin on the 12th. But for all adults, we're going to have a ministry fair in the gym. Encourage you to come, be a part of that. That will share not only what's going on as far as Sunday morning studies, but lots of different small group opportunities and different ministries. So plan on being there. There will be goodies and just a time for fellowship around that as well. This Tuesday, and I think this is rather timely again with the elevation of so much that's going on. We've got a prayer service that we're going to have here in the sanctuary Tuesday night from 6:30 to about 7:15. So relatively short, but a time for us to come together and pray over all these things that are going on, things happening in our own individual lives and families and throughout our country and world. So I hope you can come take advantage of that. Trust me, no one will be put on the spot in terms of needing to pray or needing to say anything. It will be a relatively safe, simple, and yet, I believe, a powerful time to come together to put ourselves again into God's hands. And then there are lots more information that you can glean out of the emails, email updates that I send couple times each week. If you're not on that email list but would like to be, stop at our information station. We've got cards there to fill out with your email address. Check the appropriate boxes. You can put in one of the offering baskets. But that's the best way to stay up on what's coming up, some celebrations of what has happened, and ways for us to engage and be involved together in the ministry the Lord has given us here. Next Sunday, Labor Day weekend, we're going to wrap up our summer series, Living in Tension, and we're going to shift this one Sunday to the prophet Isaiah. In chapter 35, it's some cool things that the Lord has to say when it comes to hope in the midst of tension. So we're going to hear again a lot about what the Lord said through Isaiah with regard to hope as we live in the times that we do. Hope you can join me. And for now, go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.